technologies to pharma companies and banks. And one of the new technologies that came along at the time was RFID. So back in sort of 2001, the FDA was thinking about mandating RFID on every drug in the supply chain. Never happened. Walmart at the same time was going to put RFID on everything, and that has a long storied history. The short story is today there actually is a lot of RFID at Walmart. But anyway, I ended up following that technology, left Sun in 2005, joined an RFID startup, and was there for 6.5 years, and saw RFID in sort of good and bad forms, everything from Egyptian airports to Colombian weapons to airplane parts. And after I swore in 2011 I would never do RFID again, I was sitting and having dinner with a friend of my wife who was a pharmacist, local to the area at the time, no longer local. And she talked about how she had spent all day long tackling one of these things. So a lot of folks who even spend time in hospitals, docs who are using these kits that already exist in hospitals, don't really think about it. It's sort of like, where does the trash go when you throw it out? You know, it goes somewhere and we don't really think about it. The reality is, what happens, this is a, what we're looking at here is a anesthesia kit. So Georgetown's actually using the technology. This isn't one of Georgetown's kits, but if you go to Georgetown, there's a, you know, very similar sort of kit. They'd hand the doctor this tray in the morning. They would go and use various drugs to put people to sleep and wake them up again. And at the end of the day, about 80-85% of those drugs are still there. Thankfully, they didn't get used and they weren't needed. But what ends up happening is down in the pharmacy, there's a whole fleet of people. And there's a technician that manually picks up every one of those drugs and says, all right, well, let me look at the expiration date here. This one, actually, surprisingly, this vial of sterile water is not expired. August 2016, I've had it for a long time, so it means it's long dated. But they're looking to see what's expired, what's missing, you know, what's been used, and what needs to be replenished. So that process, as you can imagine, if you're picking up 50, 60, 100, 200 items, can take quite a long time. If you're doing it right, it takes about 15 minutes for a technician to process a kit. Then once they think they have it right, they hand that kit over to a registered pharmacist. And the registered pharmacist has to pick up every vial again. And it drives people nuts because, like, here you went through pharmacy school 6 years and, you know, you're trying to help people and do clinical stuff, and here you are checking to see is this sterile water expired. So it takes another 15 minutes for them to check all that and then fill out some regulatory paperwork saying what's the first drug that's expired. And so now we've spent a half hour going and manually processing this kit, and 20% of the time we've gotten it wrong. So that's where this process came in. So what have we done? We've taken RFID technology, we put a tag on each drug that goes in the tray. So you take this one manual step and you've replaced what are effectively 16 manual steps, because over the course of the life of most vials of sterile water, not this particular one, it will go up in a kit and come down 8 times, get touched by 16 people. So yes, you had to manually apply this tag, although that's going away with some of the partnerships we're doing. For that one manual step, you've saved 16. And what ends up happening is you put the drugs that are tagged into the kit that already existed. You then put the tray into this thing that looks like a blue oven. We call that the scanning station. It's an RFID reading station. Hit a button on our cloud-based technology, and it says, all right, you're missing these things are expired, these things are missing. So what took 15 minutes takes less than 5 seconds. They replenish, recheck it. Because it's an automated check, in most states you no longer need a pharmacist, and you're sub 3 minutes to do the entire process from start to finish. So what that ends up meaning is we're about 90% faster, 100% faster than pharmacists on the pharmacist side. From an error perspective, University of Maryland conducted a study. We went from, they were saying 5%. I will tell you that we've never actually seen a hospital with as low as a 5% error rate. So I would argue that it was probably higher than that. But about 1 in 5 kits with an error to 0. And you have a huge reduction in inventory because it's so slow to process these kits. If you look at Georgetown, for example, they would have the equivalent of basically one tray per OR per day that is out in the field and one that is back in the pharmacy because it's taking all day to process all these trays. Now you can have the one that's out in the field plus just a small amount of reserve stock. So in most cases, you're saving 40% of the stock in the OR trays, and you're able to now get visibility of what's actually being used. And there's side benefits. So, you know, we talk a lot about this sort of workflow benefit, but the real value here is we're starting to provide real-time visibility to what's going on with all your meds in the meds that have the least amount of visibility. So if there's a recall, we just punch in that lot number. We know instantly where those recall drugs are. We actually also know where the recall drugs have been if I've already administered a drug that's recalled. And there are situations where this particular vial of propofol here was found in a bathroom. And the hospital called us up and said, hey, can you tell us about it? And we were able to say, yeah, you know what? It was tagged by this person on this particular day, went into this kit, went into that kit, and was checked out to this particular provider. So they were able to immediately find the diversion incident. Huge thing that really they would have had no ability to do in the past. And, you know, safety and diversion and even time savings is all sort of mom and apple pie. But as we all know in healthcare, nothing gets done unless you're actually saving money. So the general value proposition is, you know, spend a buck, save five. In a combination of reduced labor, reduced inventory, reduced safety issues, reduced expiration waste, and the ability to actually charge patients for the drugs that you use that a lot of times are not captured. So in the background, what we're doing is we're tracking what's going on, and we're able to help our hospitals optimize their use of the system. So this is actually a real-time snapshot that Hugh took the other day of Georgetown and their uses. So they're saving about 40 hours of time a week. If we look at the types of meds that they're tagging, unsurprisingly, propofol is the number one. I can tell you across all of our hospitals, propofol represents 11% of all drugs. And we can start to look at spikes. It looks like right around the turn of the year, there's going to be, or that's almost 2017, there's a bunch of drugs that are expiring. And it's not that detailed, but somewhere around December, there's another spike in expiring. So I can start to predict workflow. I can start to order ahead and really optimize my use. We can, in some cases, even say, hey, let's shift meds from one kit type to another kit type or one kit type to another part of the floor so I know that those meds are going to get used rather than wasted. So this, we started in 2011. We spent 2011 after that dinner doing two things. One was R&D, and the second was calling around to MedStar included to see, hey, would anyone actually want to buy this thing? And I have to say, at the time, MedStar said no, but they've since come around. And we figured out, though, that someone said yes. So University of Maryland was our first client. NYU was our second in 2012. We went out to San Francisco to a healthcare incubator called Rock Health. At that time, we flipped our business model. So one thing that we found is that hospitals, as everyone sort of knows, have a hard time buying capital equipment. And particularly when you have a new technology, it's hard to justify the savings until you've tried it. So what we've done is we sell the system by selling the tags that go on the drugs, and we give away the hardware, the software, and the services for free. That aligns the value you're deriving from the system with the price that you're paying, and that's been very successful. So we now have more than 200 hospitals across the country. And we're happy to include Georgetown in that mix. We've been growing since then. We raised our Series A venture funding in 2013. We raised our Series B. Kaiser Permanente led it early this year, and have been seeing, you know, exponential growth in both tagging as well as consumption. So the top line represents the tags that have been printed, and the bottom line here represents tags that have been used or expired out of kits. So we've been seeing good, steady growth. So again, going back to what our vision is and what we're trying to do, we optimize this very specific process that was the black hole of med management. But the idea is we've given people a taste to what you can do if you start to have better visibility to meds. So the idea was start with kits, provide a good solution that uses consumer-facing types of technology, so web, RFID. And if you look at our user interface, it's a very much a consumer-y feel rather than a commercial feel. You know, there's too many pieces of software out there that are in the hospital that are just really difficult to use. We find when we go and we train people, technicians and pharmacists at first are really afraid because they're like, oh geez, I'm gonna have to learn another system. They get up, they hit, literally there's a blue button that says scan, and that's all they have to do. I'm like, wow, that actually was easy. So training takes less than 15 minutes. And what we want to do is take that experience that we've started with kits and provided a slice of visibility and go broader. So we already are providing some visibility into the OR with meds that are flowing through the OR, but our second place is called anesthesia check, where we're providing real-time information to the providers about the meds and how they're being used and where are their safety issues, where can they properly document a little bit better. But over time, capture more and more of the meds and supplies and understand, you know, am I managing my supply chain inside the hospital properly? So to go a little bit more into the second product, anesthesia check, basically, if we think about that doc who checked out that kit for the day, once they go into the OR, what they're typically going to do is drop a number of syringes. And what they're supposed to do is they're supposed to put a color label that represents what the drug is on that syringe. We'll tell you the compliance rate, and actually MassGen just released a piece of research last week on this, is less than 50%, unless, of course, the Joint Commission is coming through. So what this allows them to do is just take a drug, wave it right by the system, it automatically generates their label for them. And the reason why they would want to do that, not only is it easy, but then when it comes time to actually administer it to the patient, they can just wave the syringe by the patient where they're administering it, and it will pop up on their electronic medical record and say, all right, I'm giving propofol, for example. Now they don't have to document in the EMR. It's going to do safety checks to make sure that that propofol is not expired, not recalled, that they're not allergic to it. And their med documentation is going to be accurate, and for their controlled meds, it'll automatically deduct what controlled meds they've used versus been checked out, and then virtually submit the DEA record, which is, you know, a lot easier than they would have done before. So the idea is for the provider, it's you know, faster to do a compliant workflow, and actually faster than doing a non-compliant workflow. It's much safer because we have all these checks in place, and it gives the pharmacy a level of visibility that they would have never had. So I can now, particularly with the generics that are rising in price, so like neostigmine, for example, used to be you know, pennies, and now you're talking about tens of dollars. So you're having all sorts of situations where people are multi-dosing off of non-multi-dose where they shouldn't be, and we can start to understand, well, should we be buying smaller vials? Should we be buying pre-filled syringes? Because it will ultimately be cheaper and we're wasting a lot of drug. Right now, what's happening is we're documenting, hey, there's some neostigmine over here, but we're not actually accounting for what was in that vial or in the syringe or goes to the patient. We now have full visibility into that. So we're taking that concept, we're taking the kits concept, and we've put enterprise-wide reporting on it. We use a system called Tableau, which is one of the leaders in sort of business intelligence, to be able to mine all of the data that's in the system and allow individual hospitals to understand a lot better what's going on with their inventory, and if they're like MedStar and have a group of hospitals, they can look across the sites and understand what's working and what's not. Along with that, we have a number of partners that we think are important to the overall picture. So if you look at my slides advancing, the pharmacy is buying the RFID tags from their drug wholesalers, which is making it easier for them to acquire. We've set up relationships with the group purchasing organizations, but just as importantly, we have folks like SafeCore Health that will apply the tags for the hospital, and other folks like Healthcare Logistics, which will provide pre-tagged serial numbers to meet compliance around locked kits in different places. So as we build out the ecosystem, we want to be integrated with all the right parties so that it's truly, you don't have to think about it, you just are collecting the data and then able to mine it along the way. So that's where we are today. It's been a long journey since 2011, but a fun journey, and happy to just kind of open it up for questions, whether it's on the technology or the startup process or whatever you like. Yes, these are passive UHF.
Why don't you explain passive versus
UHF? Yeah, sure. So real quick, what the difference, a lot of hospital RFID is what we call an active tag. Active tag has a battery and it generally beacons. So what that means, if you think about easy pass, you'll have a battery in there and you're gonna get distance and sometimes location. A passive tag, if you're not in the presence of something that's trying to read it, this is, you know, it's basically the same as a paperclip. It's just a piece of an antenna and a little piece of silicon. If you're in the presence of a reader, the reader will send out a signal and it's going to get the energy out of the air to power up, and then it screams back a unique number saying, I am this particular vial of sterile water. So that's what this technology does, much cheaper.
So have you explored other supply chain areas outside of medication as a possible area for this?
We have, and actually in the past I've dealt a lot with, for example, the stent makers and the cath lab, as well as ortho implants. Mm-hmm. The reason why we started with meds is we felt like we had better control of the full set of meds in a particular area. One of the challenges, for example, with the, let's go with the cath lab, you have good sections of the inventory that are actually vendor managed. So you have to get the vendor on board as well as the hospital, and you have to get all the vendors on board. But yes, we're thinking that that is a longer term play.
Can you describe the process again of what happened when you put the kids in the oven?
Yeah, sure. So they put the tray into the oven. Let me go back to the oven. Go to a website, hit a scan button, and it just scans for 5 seconds. So basically the antennas are powering up all the tags and saying, you know, what are all these tags? It's matching that versus the template that the hospital has created for the kit. And it says, all right, well, versus that template, you are missing these three items. And here's also what's expiring soon within the thresholds that I set. So then the technician goes and replenishes, hits the scan button again, and then they go. Does that answer your question?
So it tells them what's missing, and then they fill it, and then they rescan it.
That's
and
right.
The kit itself has its own tag, so it knows what it's...
What type of tag, yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you have enough distance and location to know if a vial is in the wrong slot?
No. So it's very difficult to get... actual location inside the kit, just because there's so much bouncing around of the signal, you can't get to that level of accuracy.
I have two questions. One on the technology side. With RFID, are there limitations on the readability of the tags? So if you have two tags that include each other or you have stacked objects, is that...
Great question. A lot of what we spent 2011 doing was answering sort of two questions there. One is just what you were talking about. If you have two tags that are right on top of each other, it causes interference. And then the second problem is if you took this tag and it's on sterile water, but if you had a big vial and you put it like this on liquid, the liquid will suck all the energy out of it. So we had to solve the liquid problem and the stacking problem. This particular antenna design is proprietary to us, and it solves both of those problems.
So if you had a basket of items that are somewhere on top of each other,
yes,
that would pose problems?
No, it'll work perfectly well with our tags.
Oh, okay.
But with normal passive UHF tags, you'd probably have an issue.
Okay. And the second question I have is, can you talk just generally about how you move from kind of that exciting dinner to prototype product? And like
So that was in, I want to say it was March of 2011, and we knew the challenges were liquids and stacking. So I purchased some equipment in my apartment and sort of wired something up, created kind of like a metal box, And I actually started testing on tonic water, of all things, because tonic water had some sugar in it, and but it was liquid, and I knew how to create a really difficult test plan out of that. So that probably took, I don't know, the better part of 6 months doing various phases of that, different types of tags, different types of reader setups and things like that. And then in the meantime, we were calling different hospitals and saying, hey, what do you think of this? What do you think of this? What do you think of this? So we felt pretty decent about the RF side of the technology by, I would say, November, December of 2011. And the software, we were getting close. We signed a contract with Maryland in February and then we of 2012, and we went live in April of 2012. Yeah. So, and I will tell you, that night before we went live in Maryland, it was a terrifying night. It was definitely one of those nights you didn't sleep. I'll never forget. We go up to Maryland, we bring the equipment, and we had never actually used the system on real drugs. So it was, we definitely tested on something that was a lot harder than drugs, but you never really know. And we go and we tag our very first kit, which is a pediatric emergency tray. And just as we're going to hit the scan button for the first time, our buyer, the director of pharmacy, walks in the room. And, you know, it sort of feels like one of those blue screen of death moments. And I was like, oh, Mark, do you want to see the very first scan? I hit that scan button. I held my breath. And it worked. And I was like, all right, we've got something. We don't have to, like, return it and, you know, all go home and, you know, with our heads down. So we went from there.
Sorry, last one.
Yeah.
Is there, with this kind of technology, are there regulatory challenges, or is it virtually unregulated?
From an FCC perspective or FDA perspective?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So from an FCC perspective, we are following the standards for the UHF ISM band. So there's a standard set called EPC Class 1 Gen 2, and we're within all the sort of power and frequency standards there. From an FDA perspective, there really isn't anything. There are some state board of pharmacy regulations that you have to meet in certain states, Ohio being sort of the most tricky of them. But for the most part, actually, the regs have helped us rather than hurt us because, for example, McKesson back in the 90s created these unit dose robots that allowed for this concept of automated checking, which allowed you to get rid of the pharmacist check. And we're able to ride on those regulations to get rid of the pharmacy check today. So actually, from a drug perspective, we've been helped by the regs rather than hurt by the regs.
How much does a tag cost, and what's the process for associating a tag with a particular vial to know what drug is in the expiration date?
Yeah. A drug is anywhere from 79 cents to $1.39, kind of depends on volume and things like that. And the process, there's three different processes. You can buy something that already comes pre-tagged, my personal favorite. This tag here came out of a printer, and the way that it works is you barcode scan the NDC, enter the lot number and expiration date twice if you haven't seen it yet, once if you have seen it, and then you print a case quantity, so you'll do a full case at a time. Or the alternative is you put the tags on, they're blank tags, put them in the scanning station, hit the scan button, and then basically NDC lot number expiration date. Once you've gone and done that printing and applying step, then all the drugs get set aside and a pharmacist will go and put them back in the scanning station, hit the scan button and validate NDC lot number expiration date quantity. So that way, we're absolutely 100% sure the right tag is on the right drug.
So the vials themselves have a barcode.
But it only provides the drug type. It doesn't have expiration or lot number.
So you have to manually add that.
Mm-hmm. In 2017, that should change. But yes, it is kind of annoying.
So as an anesthesiologist that practiced in the 90s and the early 2000s, I'm just thinking about how much trouble this would have saved us because syringe swaps are
a little bit. Oh, it's huge, yeah. Yeah.
And also varying colleagues, because we might have been able to identify drugs that have recognized. And it made me also think about other things in the operating room where, and I was wondering if this is something like this people with blood administration, because the most common cause of blood transfusion mismatch is a clinical problem. And so I was wondering if the technology is adapted.
There's really no reason why it couldn't be. It's just something we haven't focused on. In fact, actually, it's interesting you bring up blood because I would say in the top 10 sort of next things we do, that one always rises. It doesn't necessarily rise up to number one, but it's almost always fairly high on the list. Yeah. Well, great.
That's great, Kevin. Thank you.
All right. Well, thanks so much for having me.